possessed by the spirits of the book is through the act of bodily dismemberment.
I don't care what happens to her. She's your girlfriend, you take care of her.
Hi everybody, I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are Armchair Directors.
Yoshi bitch. Let's go.
That's right. Pack all your friends into the Oldsmobile and drive on up to the original cabin in the woods. We're taking a look at 1981's The Evil Dead, Sam Raimi's low-budget horror classic that started a franchise.
And this is the first time I ever watched Evil Dead, as hard as it may be to believe. There's actually a few movie classics I still haven't seen. Godfather, never sat through all of them from start to finish. Evil Dead 1 and 2, never saw them before this last little stretch gearing up for the Evil Dead remake. And I absolutely loved Evil Dead 1.
Yeah.
It was so much fun. Low budget, be damned. No stars other than Bruce Campbell, be damned. I mean, all that stuff, I completely could forgive it. Now, my perspective watching this, it's not colored by nostalgia. I didn't grow up with this movie, but I absolutely loved it. I didn't care about the lack of special effects and CGI and all that. I absolutely loved it. And if this was a brand new movie coming out in theaters today, I would have absolutely went crazy for it.
Yeah, and basically it's a movie I have watched over the years, so I did go crazy for it back when I was younger because it was scary as hell.
Yeah.
You know, Evil Dead 2 is where they really add the comedy, but this one
had comedy too, not intentionally.
It has comedy in it now. At the time, they didn't intend it to be funny, but a lot of it plays pretty funny because of the effects.
Well, I've heard that, and I've asked a lot of people over the years, because I saw Army of Darkness, and I saw the end of Evil Dead 2, and I've been asking people for years, is part one serious? Is it scary, or is it kind of tongue-in-cheek like part two and especially part three? And everyone had always told me, no, actually part one is very serious. It's very serious. To that I say, horseshit. Perhaps they try, but Bruce Campbell, it's impossible for him to be serious. When he is being tortured and blood is being flung on him and then he's getting a shit kicked out of him, it is impossible to take him seriously because of the way he goes, oh God, why God?
See, but this is the thing, is that Bruce Campbell was trying to be serious because this was before he was the Bruce Campbell that we now know and love, who is a complete ham.
Yeah, but the thing is, the same goes for Sam Raimi's directing style too. Even if he was trying to make a serious, scary movie that would scare the shit out of you, his style is still so fun and quirky and weird. And it even had that classic Sam Raimi sequence with the shots, you know, cut, zoom, cut. I just do not see how this movie can be taken seriously and scary. It is just as, it's camp. It's pure camp.
It is very campy, but I can't help but wonder when you would have seen it, you know, in 1982,
it would have been different.
If it would have been that same way, because for years people passed this around on a VHS tape.
Yeah.
And we're like, don't tell anybody you've seen this thing. Yeah. Like, this is gonna scare the living shit out of you.
It was the original torture porn, I guess.
Yeah. And it definitely is filled with gore, practical effects. Some of them look great still. Some of them, you know, a little bit Harryhausen-esque stop motion that doesn't play as well, and certainly plays like camp. And there are those moments now that, like, at the time, the tree rape played a little bit more intense than I think it does now, where we're just, like, you know, laughing at some of these scenes.
No, the tree rape's still intense. It's still way too intense. And that was the one scene in the movie that took me out of it. They went a little too far with that
They went pretty far with that one.
That's, like, the one anomaly in the entire movie. Like, what the hell? You can torture people and you can have demonic spirits and people can be bleeding and appendages severed and all that. But as soon as you go into, like, sexual type of, you know, assault, rape, that type of stuff, I think you cross a very definite line.
For sure.
And, oh my God, did they cross it in this one. Holy shit.
Yeah.
They didn't dance around it. They took the line and set it on fire and nuked it.
Right. It was sort of like a badge of honor that they nuked the line.
Yeah. But aside from that, super fun movie. Love the cast in it. It's a very small cast, but they do a great job, and it's kind of cool how they get picked off as the movie goes on, as, you know, classic aliens movies do that too, and other horror films. And Bruce Campbell just hands down is the star, the gem of this movie.
Well, it's funny because this is a movie that sort of switches gears, because at first you're not sure who the star is if you didn't know watching it that Ash was going to be the star.
Right.
Because for a while, it seems like it's, you know, the other guy and then the girl. And then you're like, no, it's this guy. This schmo is going to step up to the plate and end up being the star of the movie.
Literally the schmo. And in a lot of movies at that time period were doing that. They were throwing the scent off. Mm-hmm. Alien, the original Ridley Scott Alien, did that perfectly with Ripley, who seemed to be just another victim ending up being the star of the movie. So that's cool how the schmo, literally just a schmo,
right.
the kind of nice guy, ends up being the star. And it's kind of funny that Ash absorbs that blonde asshole for the rest of the movies.
Right.
He becomes the obnoxious asshole that blonde was in the first movie.
Yep. So time for best part.
Worst part.
Go ahead.
Best part, hands down, Bruce Campbell. I've read some of Bruce's books, and he talks about how Sam Raimi just loves to torture
him. Oh, yeah.
And reading those books, I'm thinking, well, Raimi kind of sounds like an asshole for doing that.
Throwing stuff at him off camera.
Like, geez, that's cruel. But after watching this movie, I totally get it.
Yeah.
I never really take enjoyment in watching people suffer, except for Bruce Campbell. That was freaking hilarious. It's just a blast watching him being tormented by the evil, just because his reaction, oh God, why me? No.
Yeah.
When they're puking on him and bleeding on him, and it's just like, I hope this never stops. I could watch this all day long. That final shot in the movie when the evil, I just call it the evil, when it's the shaky cam.
Yeah.
And it's just flying through the air. That final shot where it sneaks up on him, he turns around and he screams. Just beautiful end of this movie. Worst part is the tree rape. Wow. Holy shit. I mean, just when I'm like kind of uncomfortable, I'm like, oh my God, please. Yeah. I hope this. Woomph! I'm like, what the fuck was that?
Right.
Other than that, super fun movie.
Yeah. I'm going to say worst part, certainly some of the effects that just don't quite hold up as well. Mostly just the stop motion stuff. It's funny now, but I think because they intended it to be scary and now it's funny, it just takes me out of the movie. Whereas when we get to Evil Dead 2, I don't mind that stuff. Mm-hmm. But in Evil Dead 1, that would be the worst part, along with the tree rape, just because that's horrible.
Yeah.
Best part, Evil Dead vision. So Raimi's direction, maximizing a low budget, but just the way that, that through the forest, the zzzz, is so awesome that it's one of those things that, like, every movie needs to have that.
Yeah.
Just so great. So Raimi's direction, hands down, the best part of Evil Dead 1, because the acting pretty much left something to be desired for the most part, but a lot of that stuff gets ironed out when they get to the redo. Reboot, sequel, spin-off, you know, Evil Dead 2, where they up the ante quite a bit, and we're going to take a look at that very shortly.
So thanks a lot for watching, and until next time,
enjoy the show.